Hello everyone, welcome to Unacademy's YouTube channel. Let me check those emails coming up in YouTube or not. After that, we'll jump straight into the class. Okay, the stream has come up. Now let's move into the class. Now today we are going to have a quick revision on Ancient India. Okay, this is the first class. I know a lot of students will struggle with Ancient India, and many people will find it hard to revise Ancient India because the syllabus is very vast, and then a lot of people are not that much interested into Ancient India. So this will be a quick revision on Ancient India, which will be very useful for your upcoming prelims examination. Now, before going into the quick revision itself, let me give you a brief introduction about myself as well as about Unacademy. See, my name is Aravind. I completed my BE Mechanical Engineering in 2014 and almost 3 years of experience in teaching UPSC Civil Services, and I've experienced all stages of UPSC Civil Services, that is prelims, mains and then interview. My specialization subjects include polity, international relations and then current affairs. Now this is my Telegram link, unacademy_aravind. Now please join this Telegram group so that you can update yourself based on the schedule of my classes, when I'm uploading a class, all these things, or if you have any doubts regarding my classes, you can ask in this group. Now what will you get by subscribing for Unacademy? See, by subscribing to Unacademy, you will get access to daily live classes where you get to watch videos, you can re-watch them, and then you can ask doubts if you like. Okay, now this rewatchability feature is very important because with offline institutions and all, you cannot rewatch your old classes if you are having any doubts or if you want to revise stuff. But with Unacademy, since it's an online platform, you can basically rewatch your old videos. And also with regards to doubts, you can, if you have any doubts whatsoever, you can ask then and there itself. There is no need for you to wait for your turn to ask your doubts. If you have any doubts, you can ask then and there itself. And then Unacademy conducts live tests as well as quizzes almost on a daily basis, so that you get to, students can get to test themselves based on examination point of view. And then all courses in Unacademy are structured courses so that the learning process for the students becomes much easier, and it will be easier to follow courses if the course is structured in a very intuitive manner. And then you will get unlimited access to examination videos that you are subscribing for. For example, if you are subscribing for UPSC examination, you will get access to all videos concerned with UPSC examination. Now, Unacademy as a platform serves as a connector between top educators like Mrunal Patel, Mudit Gupta, Ayush Sanghi. All these top educators, they get to share their knowledge with students who hail from all over India. Now, Unacademy serves as a platform which facilitates this exchange of information between these two personnel, so that it helps a lot of students who hail from all over India, not just from urban areas. And Unacademy covers syllabus in a very comprehensive manner. Okay, so each and every nook and corner of UPSC syllabus will be covered by Unacademy. Not only that, the same syllabus will be covered by multiple faculty, so that if you are not satisfied with one faculty, you can immediately switch over to another faculty. So in a way, Unacademy is trying to democratize the learning process itself. See, in a traditional learning setting, the institute will provide you with a teacher. If you are not satisfied with a particular teacher, you cannot change from whom you are learning from. But with Unacademy, if you are not satisfied with one person, you can immediately switch over to another person. So in a way, Unacademy is trying to democratize the entire learning process by giving you the choice of where you want to learn, when you want to learn, and from whom you want to learn. Now, I also strongly suggest you guys to download Unacademy learning app so that you can keep a better track of your learning goals, how much time you are spending with Unacademy, how much time you are spending by viewing Unacademy videos, or if your favorite teacher is uploading a class in Unacademy, you will get an immediate notification in your learning app. And also, these are the amounts charged by Unacademy for plus subscription. These are very, very less compared to any offline institution where you will be spending upwards of 4 to 5 lakh rupees, which include things like fees, rent, and food. But with Unacademy, the fees part itself is very less. Not only that, you won't be spending a dime on either rent or food because you will be learning from the comfort of your home itself. There is no need for you to move into another new place like Chennai or Delhi and alter your lifestyle. With an academy, you can learn from the comfort of your home itself. Now, on top of very paltry sum that an academy is charging you for fees, if you're using my code Aranindri on top of it, you will get 10% as offer. So instead of paying 44,000 rupees, you'll be paying only 39,600 rupees for 12 months. Okay. Now, even with iconic platform where an academy will provide you with a personal coach to guide you through the process of preparing your PSC, an academy will provide you with a daily mains question answer practice, study planner, personalized feedback based on your performances. Now, even with iconic platform, if you are using my code Aravind V, you will get 10% as offer. Okay, so please don't forget to use my code Aravind V in case you want to get this 10% as offer. Okay, so that's introduction and promotion done by with people. Let's move on to today's quick revision. Okay, today we will have a quick revision on ancient India topics. Now, this is just part one. Tomorrow also, I will have another class. Okay, so just by watching this class, you can have a quick revision on ancient India. Okay, so when we talk about ancient India, we have to start with Indus Valley Civilization. Indus Valley Civilization. Now, this is a very quick revision. I'm not going to explain all the concepts in a very in-depth manner. Okay, so this is just a quick revision. Okay, now when we talk about Indus Valley Civilization, first we have to talk about geographical setting. Now, the Indus Valley Civilization was in Bronze Age Civilization. Okay, that is, it was a mature phase that lasted between 2500 to 1900 BC, extended from what today is northeastern Afghanistan to Pakistan and northwest India. Since in the Indus Valley Civilization preceded Iron Age, the Harappas were unaware of the use of iron, but the use of copper, bronze, silver and gold was noted. Now, this is very, very important. Okay, the usage of iron was not known to Harappan people. Okay, because they preceded Iron Age, but other metals like copper, bronze, silver and gold, they were aware of. Now, along with ancient Egypt and Mesopotamia, it was one of the early three civilizations of the world. So, this is a geographical setting of Indus Valley Civilization. Now, moving on, if you look at the Harappan cities and town planning, it was the first urban settlement in the region. Okay, now the Harappans were excellent city planners. The quality of municipal towning planning suggests that the knowledge of urban planning and efficient municipal governments, which placed a high priority on hygiene. Okay, so Harappans were basically very efficient in urban planning, and their urban planning placed a lot of emphasis on hygiene. This is very, very important. Now, the Harappan city was divided into upper town called a citadel. In citadel, rich people lived, and the lower town. Now, the lower town was residential area where common people live. However, some cities did not follow this model. Okay, so if this is Harappa, if this is an Harappan town, there will be an upper area called as citadel. There will also be a lower area called as lower town. In citadel, rich people live. In lower town, some common residential areas were found. However, some cities did not follow this model of citadel and lower town. Now, the city streets were based on grid system and oriented to east to west. Okay. Now, the roads and streets intersected at right angles. Now, they were covered in drains along the road. Houses were built on either side of the roads and streets. Each street had a well-organized drain system. Now, remarkable use of burnt bricks were found in Harappan civilization. The ratio of this burnt bricks were remarkably similar across IVC cities. Okay, so the ratio of 4:2:1. Okay, so the fourth is length, depth, and then width. So this ratio 4:2:1 was found similar across all IVC cities. So it suggests that all these cities during the same era belong to the same civilization called as Harappan civilization. Now, houses had the same plan, a secure courtyard around which there were a number of rooms. Entrance to the houses were from the narrow lanes which cut the streets at right angles. No windows faced the street. Okay, so what does it suggest? If there is no windows that is facing the street, what does it suggest? Harappans value privacy a lot more than other civilizations. Okay, so there is no windows facing towards the street. What will happen? What can we imply? happens well previously. That's the reason why houses also cut streets at right angles. Okay, so that anyone walking down the street cannot take a look into the house. Now, let's take a look at some major sites. Now, associated river along with these major sites, and then some major findings along these sites. First, let's look at Harappa. Harappa is located in Punjab, Pakistan region, and the major river that flowed through Harappa was Ravi River. Now, Harappa city had a fortified wall, R37 cemetery, copper chariot with canopy, evidence of pre-Harappan to mature Harappan stage, workman's quarter, copper specimen of bullock quarter. Okay, these were the findings found in Harappa. Now, if you look at Mohenjo-daro, which is found in Sindh, Pakistan region, on the banks of Indus River, great granary, a small fragment of cotton, the bronze dancing girl, well known for the bait bath in Mohenjo-daro. Okay, so since they have found a small fragment of cotton, what can we deduce? Cotton was known to Indus Valley civilization. Okay, this is very, very important. This can be asked in prelims question. Okay. Now, another site regarding Harappan civilization is Kalibangan, which is in Rajasthan, and Ghaggar River flowed through Kalibangan. Now, this site is famous for mud brick fortification, evidence of earliest datable earthquake, discovery of plum field, fire altars. Channu-daro in Sindh, Pakistan, on the banks of River Indus. Archaeologists have found a manufacturing site during Harappan period. Now, another site is Banavali in Haryana, along the banks of Saraswati River. Pre-Harappan and Harappan sites were found in this region. Remains of streets and drains were also found in this region. Now, the next region is Sukta Gendur in Baluchistan, on the banks of River Dasht. Now, this Sukta Gendur is a trade point between Harappan civilization and Babylon, situated on a natural rock. Another civilization is found in Lothal, Gujarat, on the banks of River Bogava. Now, this Lothal is a coastal city, coastal site. Dockyard was built with brick in this region. Okay, and pottery with painting of clover fox was also found in Lothal, Gujarat. Now, the next site that was excavated is Surkadota in Gujarat. Now, in Surkadota, speculation about fossil remains of horses were found. Okay, so there was a question regarding this factor in 2017 prelims, I believe. Okay, there was a question asking horses were known to Harappan civilization, because the evidence of horses was found only recently, but a lot of old NCRTs did not update that information in their book. So many people thought that horses was not known to Harappan civilization, but in reality, horses was found in as a fossil remains in Surkadota. Okay, so that statement was correct in that time. Now, similarly, there is another Harappan site called as Rangpur in Gujarat, on the banks of River Bandar. Now, here plant remains such as rice, millets, and possibly bajara was found. Now, another Harappan site is Rakigar Ghi in Haryana, and it's a well-planned city was found in this area. Now, the next one is Dholavira. In Dholavira, unique water management system was found, and largest Harappan inscription and use of fire altars was also found in this region. Okay, so these are the important Harappan sites, their associated rivers, as well as findings in this region. Now, this is very, very important for prelims perspective. Now, give me a moment here. If you look at the economy of Harappan civilization, first let's take a look at the trade and transportation features of Harappan civilization. Now, granaries are found at Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, Kalibangan, and Lothal. So, in these four sites, granaries were found. Now, large granaries were located near each citadel, which suggested that the state stored grain for ceremonial purposes and possibly the regulation of grain production and sale. As I mentioned before, citadel is where most of the rich people in a town lived. Okay, so if grains were stored near citadel, it showed that grains were also used for ceremonial purposes, and also the state heavily regulated the production of grain as well as their sale. Now, the Harappans conducted considerable trade in stone, metal, shell, etc. with Indus culture zone. However, their cities did not have the necessary raw materials for commodities they produced. Now, Harappan civilization did not use metal money. In weights and measures, mostly 16 or its multiples were used. Okay, so when they are measuring weights, 16 or multiples of 16 was used when they are measuring weights for different products. Now, this is with regards to trade and transportation features. Now, what were the trade links that was established during Harappan civilization? Now, the Harappans had commercial links with Afghanistan and Iran. They set up trading colony in northern Afghanistan, which evidently facilitated trade with Central Asia. Now, the Harappans carried out on a long distance trade with lapis lazuli. Lapis objects may have contributed to the social prestige of the ruling class. Okay, so Harappan carried out long distance trade of this lapis lazuli. Now, the Mesopotamian records from about 2350 BC onwards refer to the trade relations with a region called as Meluha, which was ancient name given to the Indus region. Now, the Mesopotamian texts also speak of two intermediate trading stations called as Dilmun and Makan, which lay between Mesopotamia and Meluha. Now, Dilmun is probably identifiable with Bahrain on the Persian Gulf. Now, archaeologists have discovered a massive dredged canal and what they regard as the docking facility at the possibly carried exchanges through a barter system in the coastal city of Lothal in western India, in Gujarat. Okay. So, if you look at the trade links of Harappan civilization, they heavily traded with both internally as well as outside of Harappan civilization with Mesopotamian region. Okay. So, the trade links were happened through intermediate trading station called as Dilmun as well as Makan, and archaeologists have also discovered a trading post, also a docking facility in Lothal in western Gujarat. And most of the trade exchanges happened via barter system. This is very, very important. They did not have any access to metal money at that time. Now, the next important economic feature regarding Harappan civilization is agriculture. Now, the pharaohs discovered that in the pre-Harappan phase at Kalibangan, it indicates that the fields were ploughed during Harappan period. Okay, so if there was any agriculture that was carried out during Harappan civilization, the fields were ploughed. Now, the Harappans probably used wooden plough drawn by oxen as well as camels. Harappan villages mostly situated near the flat plains produced significant food grains not only for their inhabitations but also the town's people as well. Now, the Indus Valley civilization produced wheat, barley, ragi, peas, etc. A substantial quantity of barley was discovered in Banavali in Haryana. Now, in addition, sesame, mustard were also grown in Harappan civilization. At Lothal and Rangapur in Gujarat, rice husk was also found embedded in clay as well as pottery. The Indus people were the earliest people to produce cotton, and because of this, Greeks people call this area Sindon, which is derived from the word Sindh. Okay. So, this is some information regarding economic features of Harappan civilization, everyone. Okay, so we have revised some in the economic information of Harappan civilization. Now let's take a look at some information on Harappan script. Now, the Harappans invented the art of writing like the people of ancient Mesopotamia. However, the Harappan script is yet to be deciphered. Now, the Harappan script is not in alphabetical but largely pictographic. There are many specimens of Harappan writing on stone seals and other objects. Most inscriptions were recorded on seals and may contain only very few words. Now, what is with respect to animals in Indus Valley civilization? Now, in Indus Valley civilization, animals were raised on a large scale. Animals like oxen, buffaloes, goats, sheep, pigs were domesticated. Humped bulls were also favored by the Harappans. There is evidence of dogs as well as cats and asses and camels being bred in Harappan civilization. Now, the evidence of horse comes from superficial level of Mohenjo-daro and from doubtful terracotta figurine from Lothal. The remains of a horse was also spotted from Sukhothota, situated in West Gujarat and related to around 2000 BC. But the identity of this fossil remains very doubtful. From the above facts, you can interpret that the Harappan people were aware about horse, but they did not domesticate horse. So this is very, very important, you know, this is very, very important. Now, what were the religious practices of Harappan people? Now, in Harappa, numerous terracotta figurines of women has also been found. In one figurine, a plant is shown to be grown out of an embryo of a woman. This image probably represents the goddess of earth and was intimately connected with the origin and growth of plants. The Harappan therefore looked upon earth as a fertility goddess and worshipped God as a fertility goddess. Now the male deity is represented on a seal. This god has three horned heads and is represented in the sitting posture of a yogi with one leg placed above other. Now this god is surrounded by an elephant. Okay, this is very, very important. This is very, very important. This god is surrounded by an elephant, a tiger, a rhinoceros, and below his throne there is a buffalo. At his feet there were two deer. Now this seal was identified as Pashupati seal. Now there can be questions. This is very, very important. Pashupati seal is very, very important. There can be questions asked regarding Pashupati seal. Okay. Now the people of Indus region also worship trees because obviously they worship nature. Now the depiction of a deity is represented on a seal amidst branches of peepal tree. Now this tree continued to be worshipped to this day among Indians. Now the animals were also worshipped in Harappan times and many of them were represented on the seals of Harappan. Now the most important of them animals is one-horned animal unicorn, which may have been identified with rhinoceros. And also we can also find an evidence of fire altar at Kalibangan. Now, despite the depiction of divinity on seals as well as figurines, we find no architectural structure that can point it as a place of worship in Harappan civilization. Okay, so, even though Harappans, we can deduce that they believe in some sort of god or godlike figure, the archaeologists are yet to find a structure that can be pointed towards as a place of worship. Now, how did Harappan civilization decline? Okay. Now by 18,000 BC, the Indus Valley civilization saw the beginning of their decline. Writing started to disappear. Standardized weights and measures used for trade and taxation purposes fell out of use, and some cities were gradually abandoned. Now the reasons for these declines are not entirely clear, but it is believed that the drying up of Saraswati River, a process which had begun around 1900 BC, was the main cause. Now other reasons may also because of the great flood in this area, either even would have had a catastrophic effect on the agricultural activity, making the economy no longer sustainable and breaking the civic order of the cities. Now later a large group of nomadic cattle herders called as the Aryans migrated into the region from Central Asia. The Aryans crossed the Hindu Kush mountains and came into contact with the Indus Valley civilization. Now this was a large scale migration and used to be seen as an invasion, which was thought to be the reason for the collapse of Indus Valley civilization, but this hypothesis is not unanimously accepted today. Okay. So these are the reasons for the end of Harappan civilization. Okay. So we have successfully revised Harappan civilization, everyone. Okay. Successfully revised Harappan civilization. So if you have any doubts so far, please ask those doubts right now. I'll give you 1 minute to ask your doubts. After that, I'll be moving on to the next part. Okay. Okay, you have given ample amount of time to ask your doubts. Okay, so let's move on to the next part. Okay, so we have discussed Harappan civilization now. Okay, so now let's discuss Vedic and later Vedic period. Okay, now I mentioned before that Indus Valley civilization was during Bronze Age. Okay, it was during Bronze Age. So Indus Valley civilization people, they were not aware of iron, but Vedic and later Vedic period belong to Iron Age. Now, during later Vedic and Vedic period, a new culture flourished and was spread across Ganga as well as Yamuna plains. This culture came to be known as the Aryan culture. Now, the Aryans settled on the banks of the river Indus, Sindhu and Saraswati, which is now non-existent. Okay. Now, this is the Vedic literature of Vedic literature during the period. Vedas, there are four different types of Vedas: Rig Veda, Sama Veda, Yajur Veda as well as Atharvana Veda. Now, if you look at Brahmana, Aitreya and Kaushtiki, Jamini, Shatapta, Taitriya and Gopata. Now, if you look at Aryanka, Aitreya and Kaushiki were considered as Aryanka, and Chandogya and Jamniya, Brihadaranyaka, Taitriya, okay. And then if you look at Upanishads, Aitreya and Kaushtiki, similar to Brahmana and Aryanka were considered as Upanishads. Chandogya, Jamini and Ken, Brihadaranyaka is Katpanishad, Taitriya, Maitriyayini, Shvetashvatar, Mundaka, Mandukya, which one? Yes, it's 19,000 BC only, Krishnaveni. And if you look at Upaveda, there were four types of Upaveda: Ayurveda, Gandharvana Veda, Dhanur Veda, Shilpa Veda. Okay, so these were different types of priests during Vedic period. Okay, now if you look at Rigveda consists of 10 mantras and 1028 sutkas. Rigveda is a collection of prayers offered to Indra, Agni, Mitra, and Varuna. The third mantra consists of Gayatri mantra dedicated to the sun god. Now Gayatri mantra was composed by Vishwamitra. Now Gayatri mantra mentions female goddess such as Usha, Aditi, Surya. Goddess Lakshmi was also mentioned in Gayatri mantra. Lord Shiva is referred to as Rudra in Gayatri mantra. Rig Veda does not mention Lord Brahma. Now if you look at Sama Veda is an extension to Rig Veda with 75 new suktas. It is considered to be the oldest text in Indian music. It is mostly contains hymns dedicated to the sun god of Indra. It talks about the appearance and disappearance of Saraswati river, which is largely responsible for the disappearance of Indus Valley civilization. Now, if you look at Yajurveda contains yajna as well as rituals related to suktas. Rice is mentioned as Grihi in this text. Now, Yajurveda also talks about Shunya. Now next one is Atharvana Veda. Atharvana Veda consists of charms as well as spells to ward off diseases. It is also known as Brahma Veda. Its associated priest is Brahma, is considered as the highest of all four Vedic priests. It also mentions the Vedic assembly such as Sabha as well as Samiti. Now we can find reference to six types of Vedas in Mundaka Upanishads. Now these Vedas included Siksha written by Vamajya, Kalpa written by Gautam, Vyakarna written by Panini, Nirupta written by Yaska, Chanda written by Pingal, Jyotisha written by Lagada. Now this can be asked in prelims examination. Okay, this can be asked in prelims examination. They can ask questions like the following Vedas and their associated authors, and they will ask you to match that following authors. I didn't get your doubt, Krishnaveni. I didn't get your the doubt, Krishnaveni. Please, can you please elaborate? Now, let's take a look at some important facts on Vedic civilization. Now, Aitreya Brahmana talks about duties of all four varnas. Now, Mundaka Upanishad mentions the phrase Satyameva Jayate, which is found in what? We can see this inscription, we can find it in our emblem. Okay. Now Shatapta Brahmana talks about ploughing rituals as well as the concept of rebirth. Chandogya Upanishad mentions three ashramas of Varna, Ashrama, Dharma. It also talks about Itihasa Purana tradition, which is mentioned as Pancham Veda. I am not at all getting your doubts, Krishnaveni. Can you please elaborate your doubts? A Shukla Yajurveda talks about Rajasuya Yagya. Okay, so this is regarding Vedic literature. This is regarding Vedic literature. Now let's take a look at Vedic society. Now the early Vedic people worshipped the forces of nature and personified them as gods as well as goddesses. Indra, Agni, Varna, Marut were some of their gods, right? Usha, Aditi, Prithvi were some of their goddesses. Some of the solar gods and goddesses referred to in Rigveda are Surya, Savitri and Usha. Now Varna is an enforcer as well as upholder of law and order. He is known as the god of moral law. Though Aryan society was patriarchal, women were treated with dignity as well as honor. The family was the smallest social unit in Aryan civilization. Several families, also called as Kula, made the village, Grama, and several villages formed a vis. A number of villages formed a tribe or jana, which was ruled by a chief called as Rajan. Now, the chief function of a Rajan was to protect the tribe from external attack as well as to maintain law and order. He was assisted by the members of two councils called as Sabha as well as Samiti. Now, Bali or voluntary donation was prevalent in Vedic society. Cows were the measure of wealth during Vedic society. Now, why were cows the measure of wealth? Because cows contributed a lot towards the agricultural economy that was prevalent during that time. Cows can give you milk. Cows is also responsible for ploughing of fields during agriculture. And cows are very useful for other related incomes apart from agriculture. Okay, so cows were measured as a status of wealth for each individual. Rig Veda contains 128 hymns. Yes, of course, Krishna Veni. That's what Suptas means, right? That's what Suptas means, right? Now, let's take a look at what happened during the transition period from Rig Vedic period to later Vedic period. Now, the later Vedic period coincides with the painted graveware sites. Now, the later Vedic period people were acquainted with four types of pottery: black and red ware, black slipped ware, painted graveware, and red ware. The Vedic people continued to produce barley, but during later Vedic period, rice and wheat became their chief crops. Now, in later Vedic phase, agriculture became the primary source of livelihood and life became settled as well as sedentary. Now, in later Vedic times, Rigvedic tribal assemblies lost importance and royal power increased at their cost. Women were no longer allowed to sit in sabhas. The condition of women began deteriorating from later Vedic period, and they suffered on account of education and social roles which restricted them to be in the houses. Now, the later Vedic period saw the rise of fourfold Varna classification such as Brahmanas, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and Shudras and the institution of Gotra. Now, the later Vedic time also saw an established ashrama system or the division of lifespan into four distinct stages, that is Brahmacharya, also called as the period of celibacy, education and disciplined life in Guru's ashram, Grihastha, a period of family life, Vanaprastha, a stage of gradual detachment, and Sannyasa, a life dedicated to spiritual pursuit away from worldly life. Okay. So these are four stages of life span that was envisaged during later Vedic period. Now, however, it should be noted that these stages were not applicable to women or to the people of lower Varnas. Parda or Sati was not prevalent during the later Vedic period. Rig Vedic gods such as Indra and Agni lost relevance during later Vedic period, and their place was taken up by a new trinity of gods such as Brahma, who enjoyed supreme position, while Vishnu became the preserver and Shiva completed the trinity. Now, the religion became extremely ritualistic during later Vedic period. What is the meaning of ritualistic? Offering a lot of things to the god. Okay, and performing a lot of rituals for appeasing the gods. This is called as ritualistic. So what can be deduced from the religion became extremely ritualistic. Society became extremely religious during later Vedic period compared to Vedic times. Okay, so that's what we can deduce using this information. Now if you look at the socio-economic life in later Vedic period, growth of urbanization, craft production and trade resulted in the rise of guilds or shrenis, which later became castes. Okay. Now the behavior of guild members was controlled through a guild code. Customarily, the guild had the power of law. Now these guilds could act also can also act as bankers, financiers and trustees as well. Generally, these functions were carried out by a different category of merchants known as Kshetins, present-day Kshetras of North India, and Kshetris and Kshetriyas of South India. These people were Kshetris during that time. Thus, the period between 500 BC to 500 AD saw the crystallization of caste system based on their occupation. Now, the number of castes increased during this period because of the growth of number of crafts, arrival of new elements in population, inter-caste marriages and inclusion of many tribes into the caste hierarchy. Ancient history, almost 5 to 6 questions will be asked every year, Krishna Vini. Almost 5 to 6 questions will be asked from ancient history every year. Okay. Now, most people don't neglect ancient history, but most people won't study ancient history, but this gaining advantage, okay, even 5-6 questions, even though they are very less compared to 100 questions, if you are getting this right, even if you are getting at least 3 questions right, it will give a lot of leverage with regards to clearing UPSC prelims. Okay. So we have discussed Vedic civilization. Okay? We have discussed Vedic civilization. Okay, if you have any doubts so far, please ask your doubts in the chat section. I'll give you 1 minute to ask your doubts. After that, I'm moving on to other religion. Okay, heterodox religions such as Buddhism and Jainism. I'll move on to that. The PDF, I will link a link to the PDF in the comment section. Okay, after this class is over, I will link, I will give you the link to the PDF in the comment section. Is it fine for you, Krishnaveni? Is it fine for you? Okay, so I will move on to the next part. Okay, I will move on to the next part, heterodox religions. Okay, first we will discuss Buddhism, after that we will discuss Jainism. Now let's take a look at some basic details of Buddha. Now Gautama Buddha was born in the Lumbini village of Kapilavastu in Nepal in 563 BC in Shakya Kshatriya clan. Now his clan is considered themselves to be the descendants of Ikshvaku dynasty. He died in 483 BC near Kushinara, and this event is known as Mahaparinirvana. Now, Mahabhrakshakranama, or doing the great frog, is the event when Gautama Buddha left his home and discarded his worldly life. Now, if you look at the places that Buddha visited, after leaving his home in search of enlightenment, Buddha visited Vaishali and learned Shakya Darshan there. He went to Rajgriha and learned yoga. He later went to Urvala where he attained enlightenment. This event is known as Sambodhi. He then went to Sarnath where he delivered his first sermon, also known as Dharma Chakra Pravartana. Dharma Chakra Pravartana. Buddha delivered his maximum sermons from Shravasti and made Magadha his promotional center. Ashtamahastana refers to as eight significant places associated with the life of Buddha. These included Lumbini, Bodh Gaya, Sarnath, Kushinagar, Shravasti, Sankisa, Rajgriha, as well as Vaishali. Okay, so these are the eight different significant places that Buddha visited during his lifetime. Now, if you look at the chronology of places that Buddha visited, Kapilavastu first. After that, he visited Bodh Gaya, and then Sarnath, and then Kushinagar. Now, this can be asked as a prelims question. Okay, so that's why chronology is very important. Now, if you look at the contemporary and follower rulers of Buddha, okay, who were contemporary rulers of Buddha? In Ajatasattu, it was the Magadha kingdom was ruled by Ajatasattu. Kosala kingdom was ruled by Prasenjit. Vastha kingdom was ruled by Udyan, and then Surasena was ruled by Avantiputra. Okay, so these were contemporary kingdoms as well as rulers during Buddha period. Now, who are the later rulers who adopted as well as preached Buddhism? Ashoka, Kanishka, Harshavardhana, and Pala rulers, they all adopted as well as preached Buddhism during their lifetime. Gautami was the first woman to enter Buddhist Sangha. Now, what are the teachings of Buddhism? Now, Buddhism is based upon three tanas, that is Buddha's Dhamma as well as Sangha. Okay, so Buddhism is based on three tanas, that is Buddha, Dhamma as well as Sangha. Now, Buddha propagated Ashtagnik Marga, also called as Madhya Marga. He was always silent on the discussion of existence of God, but he believed in rebirth. Now, Buddha was against caste system and he opened the gates of Buddhism for all castes. Now, Buddha gave women permission to be admitted in the Sangha. Buddha suggested that when desires are conquered, the Nirvana will be attained, which means that a man will be free from the cycle of birth and rebirth once he gives his material desire. Now, Buddha's chief disciple was Upali and his most favorite disciple was Ananda. Now, there were numerous Buddhist councils. Now, if you look at first Buddhist council, it took place in Rajgriha. Now, who was the ruler during this period? Ajatasattu. Now, what was the accomplishment of first Buddhist council? Buddha's teachings were compiled into Sutta Pitaka and Vinaya Pitaka. Okay, so Buddha's teachings were compiled into two books called as Sutta Pitaka and then Vinaya Pitaka. Now, second Buddhist council took place in a place called as Kalashoka in Shishunaga dynasty, ruled by a Vaishali ruler. Now, what was the accomplishment of second Buddhist council? Buddhist Sangha was divided into two schools, that is Theravada or Stavira or Sarvastivadi. Okay, so Buddhism divided into two sects. Now, Theravada is the oldest Buddhist school with its main center in Kashmir. Mahasangic main center was in Magadha. Okay. So, in second Buddhist council, Buddhism divided into two sects. Okay, so Theravada center was in Kashmir and Mahasangic center was in Magadha. Now, if you look at third Buddhist council, it took place in Pataliputra, and who was the ruler at the time? Ashoka. Now, what is the accomplishment of this thought with this concept? Compilation of third Pitaka called as Abhidhamma Pitaka, which explains the tenets of Dhamma. Now, if you look at fourth Buddhist council, it took place in Kashmir, and who was the ruler at the time? Kanishka. Okay. Now, what was the accomplishment during the time? Compilation of Vibhasa Shastra by Vasumitra, a commentary in Sanskrit on the difficult aspects of Buddhist texts. Now, Buddhism again broke into two schools, that is Theravadi or Stavira became Hinayana, and Mahasanghik became Mahayana schools. Okay. Now let's take a look at what are the differences between Hinayana school as well as Mahayana school. Okay. Now in second Buddhist council, as I mentioned before, Buddhism broke into two aspects, Theravada Buddhism and Mahasanghika Buddhism. Now these later became to be called as Hinayana Buddhism as well as Mahayana school. Now if you look at Hinayana school is also known as Shravakyana. Now they saw Buddha as a great soul but not as God. Okay, now Hinayana school saw Buddha as a great soul but not as God. Hinayana school was orthodox in nature. Hinayana followers believed in helping themselves over others in order to attain salvation. They did not believe in bhakti and idol worship. Their scriptures were written in Pali. It was later divided into two sects, that is Vaibhashika and Sautrantika. Now, Hinayana sect can be found in today's Sri Lanka, Burma, as well as Java. Prithviraj, I'm going to I'll give you a link for this PDF in the comment section after I finish this class, Prithviraj. Okay. Now, if you look at Mahayana school, its prime center is in Andhra Pradesh. Its scriptures were written in Sanskrit. They see Buddha as an incarnation of God and started this idol worship. Now, Mahayana attaches importance to the role of Bodhisattvas who delay their own salvation in order to help others to inspire. They believed in the concept of transmigration of soul and rebirth. It was later divided into two parts. Okay. Shunyavad, was the founder of Shunyavad was Nagarjuna, and Vijnanavad. Now, in 18th century AD, Vajrayana school developed as an offshoot of Mahayana school, in which Tara is considered as a wife of Buddha. Now, in early medieval period, a new form of Mahayana called as Mantrayana came up, in which Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara began to be worshipped. Okay. So these are different types of Buddhist schools. Now, who are all the important Chinese travelers who traveled to India because of Buddhism? The first one is Fa Hai. He visited during the reign of Chandragupta Maurya during 399 to 414 AD. Next one is Huangzong. He visited during the reign of Harsha and lived in India for almost 16 years. He studied in Nalanda University. He is known as the Prince of Pilgrims. Nalanda was famous for its schools of discussion, as voted by the students who had their own hostels. King Balaputra Deva considered a temple for the students of Java who came to study at Nalanda. Now let's take a look at some Buddhist literature. Now, Tripitakas are the oldest source of studying Buddhism, which include Sutta Pitaka, which is an encyclopedia of Buddhist thought and Buddha's religious ideas. It is divided into five groups or Nikayas. They contain popular works such as Theragatha and Therigatha and Jataka tales. Now the next is Vinaya Pitakas. This book contains rules of Buddhist Sangha. Now the next one is Abhidhamma Pitaka, Buddhist principles and concept of Dhamma. Now the next one is Vishuddhimi Marga, written by Ashwa Ghosha, serves as a key composition to Tripitakas. Okay. Now, the next important Buddhist literature is Mahavastu by Hinayana sect, and Lalit Vistara by Mahayana sect are biographies of Buddha. Okay, so, Hinayana sect biographies Mahavastu and Mahayana biographies Lalit Vistara. Okay. Now, Pragya Parimita Sutra serves as the most important text for Mahayana sect. It was written by Nagarjuna, who is known as the ancient of India. Okay, who is known as the Einstein of India. Okay.
So we have discussed Buddhism, everyone. Okay, we have discussed Buddhism. Okay, if you have any doubts so far, please ask your Buddha doubts in the comment section, and I will try to answer your doubts. Okay. Please ask your doubts, everyone. Okay. After that, I'm moving on to Jainism. If you have any doubts, please ask those doubts. Okay. Okay. So I'm moving on to the next topic, everyone. Now next we are going to discuss Jainism. Now before discussing Jainism, we will take a look at some basic details of Mahavira. Now Jainism believes in the existence of 24 Tirthankaras. Mahavira is referred to as Nigantha Nataputta in Buddhist texts. Nigantha means free from bonds. Now the first Tirthankara is considered to be Rishabhadeva, who was born in Ayodhya. Pashvant was the 32nd Tirthankara of Jain tradition. He was the son of King Ashvasena of Varanasi. Yajurveda mentions three Tirthankaras of Rishabha, Ajinatha and Aristanamini. Now Mahavir Swami is considered to be the 24th and the last Tirthankara and the founder of Jainism. He was born in Kundakrama, Vaishali and passed away in Pavapuri. He was related to Magadha King Bimbisara by means of matrimonial alliances. He gave his first sermon from Vipulachal Hill near Rajgriha. Now, who were the contemporaries and follower rulers during Mahavira Swami's times? The first one is Bimbisara, Ajatasattu is a Magadha king, Udayana is a Vatsa king, and Pradyot, who is a Avant king. Okay, give me a moment here. Sorry for that. Now these were the contemporary rulers who adopted Jainism. Now let's take a look at some later rulers who adopted Jainism. Now Kalinga King Karavela, noted from Hathigumpa inscription. Rashtrakuta King Amoghavarsha wrote Ratnamalika. Chandama, daughter of Champa King, became the first woman to be admitted in Jain Sangha. Okay. So these are all the later rulers who adopted Jainism. Now let's take a look at some religious philosophy of Jainism. Now Jainism, they believe in three ratnas, that is right faith, right action, as well as right character. Jain's texts condemn the sanctity of Vedas and were against animal sacrifices in yagyas. They were, however, silent on caste system. Most of the Jain texts are written in Ardha Magadhi language. Jain monks and nuns practiced Sallekana, that is fasting until death. Jaina philosophy shares many ideals with the Sakya philosophy of Hinduism. Okay. Now, what are the different types of schools in Jainism? Jainas are divided into two sects, that is Shvetambaras and Digambaras. Shvetambaras are associated with the region of Magadha, who rule under the guidance of Satala Bahu. The subsects under Shvetambaras include Sthanakavasi and Murtipukkaja. Sthanakavasi is a sect of Jainism founded by a merchant named Lavaji about 1653 CE that do not pray to any statue. Now the Shvetambaras, who are not Sthanakavasins, are called as
Vritti Pujaka, sorry, I'm butchering all the names here, sorry for that. Now, the monks of Vritti Pujaka sect are divided into six orders or gacha. These are Karatara Gacha, Ankala Gacha, Tristuki Gacha, Tapa Gacha, Vimala Gacha, and Praswachandra Gacha. Now, the Digambaras were associated with Shravan Pelagala, whose rose under the guidance of Bandrabahu. Digambaras did not wear any clothes. Okay. Now the Digambara tradition is divided into two main orders of Mula Sangha and Kashta Sangha. Mula Sangha is further divided into four major groups such as Nandigana, Senagana, Devagana and Simhagana. Kashta Sangha too had several orders including Nandit Gacha, Mathura Sangha, Bhagata Gacha and Lata Bhagata Gacha. Now in northern India, Ujjain and Mathura were important centers of Jainism. Kankali Tila of Mathura is associated with Jains. Chalukya rulers of Gujarat gave shelter to Jainism and in early medieval period, which led to its reach in Gujarat and Rajasthan. Now Dilwara temple in Mount Abu is famous temples of Adinath, Neminatha and other Tirthankaras. Monasteries were called as Stankas in Jainism. Stanakas, sorry, not Stankas, Stanakas. Now, similar to Buddhism, there were also Jainism councils. Now, there are two Jainism councils that we have to study. Now, the first Jainism council took place in Pataliputra, who was the ruler at the time, Chandragupta Maurya. Now, what was the accomplishment of first Jaina council? Acceptance of 12 Agnas by Shvetambaras, division of Jains into Shvetambar and Digambars. Now, second Jaina council took place in Vallabhi in Gujarat. What is the accomplishment of second Jaina council? Compilation of main Jaina teachings into Agamas. Okay. Now let's take a look at Jain literature. Now Kalapa Sutra is considered to be the most important text of Jain literature. It was composed by Padrabahu in Sanskrit. Bhagavati Sutra serves as Mahavira's biography. Cheda Sutras talks about Jaina monks. Original doctrines taught by Mahavira were contained in 14 old texts known as Purvas. In the first council, Stulabhadra divided Jain canons into 12 Angas. This was accepted by Shvetambars. However, Digambars refused to accept this, claiming that all old scriptures were lost. Now, at the second council held at Vallabhi, the new additions were made in the form of Upagnas. Among 12 Angas, Archana Sutta or Code of Conduct for a Jain monk and Bhagavati Sutta expounds Jain's doctrines in comprehensive manner are the most important. Okay, so the most important Buddhist texts are Archana Sutta and then Bhagavati Sutta. This is very very important from Prelims point of view. Now most of the early Jain texts were written in Ardhamagadhi language, the language of common people. That is also one of the reasons why Buddhism as well as Jainism spread, because most of the languages used common people language like Ardhamagadhi as well as Pali language. Okay. Now apart from Jainism and Buddhism, there was another stream of religious sect called as Bhagavatism. Now Bhagavatism was a contemporary to Buddhism as well as Jainism in origin and owed its birth to the same stream of thought contained in Upanishads. Now the Gupta rulers especially provided patronage to Bhagavata sect of Hinduism. They called themselves as Bhagavatas. They worshipped Lord Vishnu, performed Ashwamedha Yagnas, gave large donations to Brahmanas and built many temples. Now the Puranas were finally compiled in this age. Vishnu emerged as a god of devotion and came to be represented as a preserver of Dharma. Numerous legends gathered around him and a whole Purana called Vishnu Purana was compiled in his honor. A law book called as Vishnu Smriti was soon named after him. Above all, by the 4th century AD, there came to be a famous Vishnava work called as Srim Bhagavat Purana, which taught devotion to Lord Krishna. Okay. So that's it, everyone. We have discussed heterodox religious texts. Okay. We have discussed heterodox religious sects. Next, we will discuss Mauryan period. Okay. Before discussing Mauryan period, if you have any doubts so far, please ask your doubts. I will give you
1 to 2 minutes to ask your doubts. After that, I'm teaching. I'm moving on to the next topic, that is Mauryan period. Okay. After this Mauryan period, I will teach Indian philosophy, in ancient Indian philosophy. After that, I will end this class. Okay. Tomorrow, I will continue this revision class on ancient India. Okay. So please come to that class as well. Okay, people have given you ample amount of time to ask your doubts. Okay, I'm moving on to the next part. Okay, the next topic that we are going to discuss today is Mauryan period. Now, let me give you an introduction to Mauryan period. Ashokan edicts are composed in Brahmi script, which was written in Prakrit language in northwestern part. They appear in Aramaic language and Kharosthi script. Now, James Prinsep deciphered the Brahmi script and thus Ashokan edicts. Ashoka is referred to as Devanam Piyadasi in his edicts. Ashoka Chakra, a wheel which was made of 24 spokes, is a part of our national flag. Now, the lion capital at Sarnath serves as our national emblem. It is carved with a considerable care, voluminous roaring lion figures firmly standing on a circular abacus, which is carved with the figures of horse, bull, a lion, and an elephant in vigorous movement. Okay, so this is some introduction regarding Mauryan period. Now, what are some of the important taxes that was levied during Mauryan period? First one is Sita, that was a tax on land. Next one is Bali, a religious tax. Baga, that was a tax on agricultural land. Now, let's take a look at some classification of edicts. Now, the Harappan edicts can be classified into major rock edicts, minor rock edicts, separate rock edicts, and major pillar edicts and minor pillar edicts. Okay, so these are the five types of classifications of edicts during Mauryan period. Now, if you look at the important edicts and their content, okay, if you look at the important edicts and their content, the major rock edict contains the ban on animal sacrifices. Now, the major rock edict 14 contains the idea, Ashoka's ideal of kinship, copies found at Shabak, Grahi, Girnar, Shopara, Duwali, Jaguda, and Yaragudi. Now, these are papers, these are places, okay. So, all these ideas, the ideas of kingship were also found in these edicts as well. The next one is Minor Rock Edict 2. This contains summaries of Ashoka's Dhamma, copies of Bhairat, Brahmagiri, Maski, Rameshwar. The name of Ashoka is found only in Maski version. Babru Edict, passages of Buddhism showing Ashoka embraced it. Barabar Cave inscription dedicated to Ajivika sect suggesting Ashoka's religious tolerance. Terai pillar inscription located in Nilgiva and Rumi Devi, okay, the birthplace of Buddha, explains Ashoka's respect for earlier Buddhas. Okay. So these are some of the major edicts and their content. Okay. Now let's take a look at the Mauryan material culture. Okay, now so far we've discussed Mauryan literature and their edicts. Okay. Now let's take a look at Mauryan material culture. Now it was marked by an intensive use of iron, prevalence of writing, punched marked coins, introduction of burnt bricks and ring wells, and northern black polished ware. Now the settlement of Sisupalgarh is ascribed to Mauryan times as it contains non-blank pottery ware and iron implements and punched marked coins. Okay. So this is a Mauryan material culture. Now let's take a look at Maurya's Mauryan period art and architecture. According to Megasthenes, Pataliputra grandeur matched that of cities of Persia. Ashokan edicts were inscribed on stone pillars that were made up of single columns. Stone pillars were erected all over Mauryan Empire with inscriptions engraved on them. The Mauryan pillars are rock-cut pillars which display the graver's skills compared to Achaemenian pillars which are constructed in the pieces by a mason. Now the top portion of the pillar was carved with capital figures like the bull, the lion and the elephant, etc. Some of the existing pillars with capital figures were found at Basra, Bakira, Lauriya, Nandgarh, Ramapurva, Sankisa and Sarnath. Now with respect to popular art, large statues of Yakshas, Yakinis are found in places such as Patna, Vidisha and Mathura. These monumental images are mostly found in standing position. One of the distinguishing elements in all these images is their polished surface. One of the finest examples is Yakshi figures in Didarganj in Patna, which is tall as well as well built. It shows sensitivity towards depicting human physique. The image has a polished surface. Terracotta figurines show a very different delineation of the body as compared to sculptures. Depiction of monumental rock cut elephant in Dhauli in Odisha shows modeling in round with linear rhythm. It also has an Ashokan rock edict. Now the rock cut cave carved at Barabar Hills near Gaya in Bihar is also known as Lomas Rishi Cave. The facade of the cave is decorated with a semicircular Chaitya arc at the entrance. The elephant face carved in the high relief of Chaitya arc shows considerable movement. The cave was patronized by Ashoka for Ajivika Center. Now it is important to note that the stupas were constructed over the reliefs of the Buddha at Rajagraha, Vaishali, Kapilavastu, Allagappa, Ramgrama, Vedapida, Pava, Kushinagar and People Veena. One of the best examples of structures of stupa in 3rd century BC is in Bairat in Rajasthan. It is a very grand stupa having a circular mound with circumambulatory path. Now the great stupa at Sanchi was built with bricks during the time of Ashoka and later it was covered with stone and many additions were made. Subsequently, many such stupas were constructed which shows the popularity of Buddhism. Now the pattern of patronage to these stupas have been very collective. One and there are few examples of royal patronage to these stupas as well. Patrons range from lay devotees to Grahapatis and kings. Donation by guilds were also mentioned at several sites. However, there are few inscriptions mentioning the names of artisans such as Kanha at Pitalakora and disciple Balaka at Kondana Caves. Despite early phase of Buddhism, Buddha is depicted symbolically through footprints, stupas, lotus throne and chakra, etc. Gradually, narrative became a part of Buddhist tradition. Thus, events from the life of Buddha, the Jataka stories were depicted on the railings and torrents of the stupas. Among the Jataka stories that frequently depicted Chandata Jataka, Vidur Pundita Jataka, Ruru Jataka, Sibi Jataka, Vesantara Jataka and Shama Jataka. Okay. So these are some of the literature and architecture during Mauryan period. Okay. Now what was the socio-economic conditions during Mauryan period? Many valuable information about social and economic conditions of northern and northwestern part of India at the time are known from Greek accounts left by Arian Admiral Nearchus and Megasthenes. They tell us about the developed conditions of many crafts, existence of brisk trade with outside world and about general prosperous condition of the country. Much has been said about these accounts of carpentry as a flourishing trade in India. Okay. Now what was the post-Mauryan developments? Okay, what were the developments in post-Mauryan period? A large-scale assimilation of foreigners in the Indian society took place only in post-Mauryan times. There was a significant advancement in foreign trade both in land via sea besides the emergence of various crafts. Okay. So we have discussed the Mauryan period. Okay. Next we are going to discuss various Indian philosophical schools. Okay. Indian philosophical school. So before going on to the next topic, if you have any doubts, you can please ask those doubts. I will answer your doubts. I'll give you 1 to 2 minutes to ask your doubts. Okay, everyone, give me ample amount of time to ask your doubts. Okay, so let's move on to the next topic. Now we will discuss Indian philosophical schools. Now, by the beginning of Christian era, 6 schools of Indian philosophy developed. They were known as Samkhya, Yogya, Nyaya, Vaisheshika, Mimamsa, and Vedanta. Now, if you look at Samkhya philosophy, according to the early Samkhya philosophy, the presence of divine agency is not essential to the creation of the world. The creation is more owed to Prakriti. Now, it was a rational and scientific view of the world. Around 4th century AD, in addition to Prakriti, Purusha or spirit was introduced as an element in Samkhya system, and the creation of the world was attributed to both. Now, the proponent of this philosophy was Kapila, who wrote the Samkhya Sutta. Okay, so this is Samkhya philosophy. It is a, in short, it is a rational and scientific philosophy. Okay, so keep this in mind. Now, if you look at yoga philosophy, yoga philosophy is a foundation based upon Yoga Sutras of Patanjali, dated from first half of the millennium AD. According to it, a person can attain salvation through meditation and physical application. Practice and control over pleasure, senses, and bodily organs is central to the system. Exercises include physical breathing exercises called as asanas and pranayama. Now, there is a broad variety of yoga schools, practices, goals in Hinduism, Buddhism, and Jainism. Among the most well-known schools are Hatha Yoga and Raja Yoga. Now, International Yoga Day is celebrated in 21st of June every year since its inception from 2015. Now, apart from these two philosophies, Nyaya philosophy is also there. Nyaya, or the school of analysis, was developed as a system of logic. According to it, salvation can be attained through acquisition of knowledge. The veracity of a proposition or a statement can be tested only through inference, hearing, and analogy. Gautama is said to be the author of Nyaya Sutras. Okay, so this Nyaya philosophy is also very scientific and very rational. Now, if you look at Vaisheshika philosophy, it gives importance to the discussion of material elements or Dravya. This school proponed that atom theory and thus marked the beginnings of physics in India. However, the scientific view was diluted with the belief of God and spiritualism, and this school put its faith in both heaven and salvation. This school was founded by Kannada. So this is a material school of thought. Okay, Vaisheshika is a material school of thought. Now, if you look at Mimamsa literally means the art of reasoning and interpretation. According to it, Vedas contains the eternal truth. The principal object of this philosophy was to acquire heaven and salvation. In order to attain salvation, it strongly recommended the performing of Vedic sacrifices. which was needed in the service of priests and legitimates the social distance between various governors. Now, this school was founded by Jamini. Okay, so this is a very orthodox school of thought. This is a very orthodox school of thought. Now, the next philosophy is Vedanta. Now, Vedanta means the end of Veda. Brahma Sutra of Badrayana, compiled in the 2nd century of BC, formed its basic text. Later famous commentaries include that of Ramanuja, okay, Brahma possesses attributes, and Shankara, Brahma is without attributes. According to it, Brahma is a reality and everything is unreal. Self or Atma is identical with Brahma. It proponed the theory of karma and the theory of rebirth. Okay, so similar to Mimamsa, it is also a very orthodox school of thought. Now, there are Indian school of thought were divided into one orthodox school of thought. Orthodox school of thought, which was divided into what? Nyaya, Vaisheshika, Mimamsa, Vedanta, so on and so forth. So, apart from orthodox school of thought, there was also heterodox school of thought. Now, this heterodox school of thought was very materialistic. Okay, they branched out of Hinduism and they became very rational, and then they became very materialistic. Okay, so this materialistic school of thought was further divided into Charvakas and then Ajivikas. Okay. Now, the school of philosophy with the emphasis on materialism developed in the period of expanding economy and society between 500 BC and 300 AD. It is outside of the ambit of six major philosophical schools. Now, this view appeared in the doctrines of Ajivikas, a heterodox sect in the time of Buddha, but the Charvaka was a main exponent under the materialistic philosophy. Charvaka's philosophy came to be known as Lokayata, or ideals derived from common people. Charvaka denies the operation of divine and supernatural agencies and makes a man the center of all activities. Okay, so these both sects, Ajivikas and Charvakas, they subscribe to extreme versions of materialistic life. Okay, so they moved away from six main philosophical schools in a very profound manner. Okay, they embraced materialistic culture because of the newfound riches that was found during the period of 500 BC to 350 AD. So that's it, everyone. Okay, this is part one of revision of ancient India. Okay, so tomorrow I will discuss the part two. Okay, tomorrow I will discuss the part two, where I will discuss Sangam age, other important dynasties after Maurya, all these things I will discuss. Okay, so if you have any doubts regarding this class, please ask those doubts. Please, everyone, I'll give you 2 minutes to ask your doubts. After that, I'm going to end this session. Okay, I'm going to end this stream. Okay, everyone, I'll give you an ample amount of time to ask your doubts. Okay, so goodbye, everyone. Tomorrow also, I'll take a class on quick revision on ancient India. Okay, so please come to the class as well. Okay, so goodbye, everyone. Have a wonderful day and have a wonderful sleep.